Hello, welcome to another edition of the Socialist.net video blog. I'm joined today by Jorge Martin, who's on the steering committee of the Solidarity with the Anti-Fascist Resistance in Ukraine campaign. Jorge, can you explain some of the latest developments in Ukraine after months of fighting between the Kiev government and the rebels in the east? We've now seen a ceasefire. Can you discuss these latest developments?
Yes, about 10 days ago, there was a ceasefire was signed between the Donetsk and Luhansk republics and the Kiev authorities, also with the participation of Russia. And this deal, the terms of which understood in different ways by different people involved, meant that the fragile ceasefire is now in place. The immediate push for this ceasefire was the fact that the Kiev forces were being heavily defeated. They had to retreat on all fronts, and there was a threat even of the rebel forces taking over the key important port of Mariupol in the south coast. So in reality, Kiev was forced to sign this deal, otherwise they would have lost even more ground. But there's a whole number of different reasons for this agreement, and there's also a whole number of forces, people who are not happy with this deal, or who see it just as a temporary stopgap. First of all, we have to say that after a number of months in which the so-called anti-terrorist operation of Kiev against the Donbas seemed to be advancing, and the rebels seem to have been surrounded in Donetsk and in Luhansk, and they were about to be cut off from the Russian border. The situation of the actual war, or the front, the battle lines, changed rapidly. Most of the Western media and the Western governments and the Ukrainian government, they said that this was because of strong intervention on the part of direct intervention of Russian forces. They were talking about 1,000 Russian soldiers having crossed the border. Then some other people talked about 10,000 Russian troops crossing the border. Then there was talk of a Russian tank column being involved. But for most of this, there was very little proof. I mean, these were the same people who were saying these things, were the same people who told us about 10 years ago that there were weapons of mass destruction in Iraq, which then we found out it wasn't the case. And there was a lot of hype at the time of the NATO summit in Wales to try to build up this idea that there was a Russian invasion of Ukraine and that something had to be done. But in reality, behind the scenes, NATO was clear that they couldn't do anything about it, and there was no real appetite or possibilities on the part of NATO to actually intervene directly and help Ukraine in such a way that they could finally smash the rebels, because that would have meant a direct conflict with Russia, which they don't want, they're not prepared for it. At a time when NATO is involved in so many different fronts, or US imperialism, which is the driving force behind NATO, obviously has all these problems in Iraq, which are of their own creation, but they don't want to be fighting in too many different fronts. They are unable, really, of fighting in many different fronts. Having said that, it is obviously clear that there was Russian involvement in Ukraine in the fighting, and in my opinion, this has been mainly taken the form of allowing supplies across the border, allowing volunteers across the border, supplying the rebels with intelligence and so on. Any talk of an actual invasion is not is completely out of the question, and they haven't actually provided any real proof for this. I mean, we live in a world where U.S. Military satellites monitor every movement that takes place in conflict zones, and they haven't been able to produce any actual evidence for such an invasion. In any case, I would say that a very powerful factor in the defeat of Kiev forces on the front was also the fact that for the local population in the whole region of the Donbas, these are occupying forces. These are armed forces which have been waging a war against civilian population. There's more and more evidence coming out of shelling, indiscriminate shelling of civilian areas, supermarkets, markets, hospitals, schools, kindergartens have been bombed by Kiev's forces without any respect for human life or non-combatants and so on. About a million people have been displaced, a million civilians have been displaced from the region. Most of them, about 800,000, have been forced to flee to Russia. 2,000 or 3,000deaths is the official Ukrainian Ministry of Health figure for people having been killed in this conflict, but it's probably much higher. So this is very difficult to win a war when you are basically considered as an occupying force, rightly so. There's another factor, and that is that the combat fighting morale of the Ukrainian forces is very, very low throughout this period of the so-called anti-terrorist operation. We have seen constant protest by wives and relatives of mothers of soldiers, because these are, after all, drafted troops, the people who were going about their everyday business, working here or there, and they were suddenly drafted into a war which they don't had any real desire to fight in most cases. Not only this, but these soldiers, the Ukrainian army, are not properly trained, so they basically sent as cannon fodder to fight in the front. They are not properly fed, not properly given body armor or weaponry or anything. And hundreds, literally hundreds of these troops were at one point or another surrounded by rebel troops or cornered against the Russian border. Some of them defected to Russia, abandoned the front. There's even a case of a military unit from Lvov in the west. They basically said, look, we have no, we haven't any more weapons, we can't continue fighting, we have no supplies. And they just basically got on a bus and went back home across the whole country. In a situation like this, really, there was a danger of the complete collapse of the Ukrainian army. And the only ones doing the fighting were the volunteer forces, these battalions, which are composed of Nazis, neo-Nazis, fascist paramilitary thugs, being legalized and incorporated into state apparatus. And yes, they might have a fighting spirit, i.e. this is a battle they want to fight against the foreign enemy or whatever they want to see it, but they are also not very good at doing the fighting, and they were heavily defeated in several battles with rebels. So the situation was not looking very good for Kiev, regardless of any Russian direct involvement of Russian troops. And they were being defeated. So this is the reason why they finally reached this deal. But there are, as I said before, a number of forces that are against this deal. On the one hand, the fascist elements on the Ukrainian side of this fight, on the Kiev side of this fight, they are not happy with this. And even today, they were protesting outside parliament. They tried to storm parliament. There was a joint demonstration of Svoboda, the far-right party, which is part of the government, the right sector, and other elements, and they said they wanted to overthrow this government. They're not happy with the signing of the deal with the European Union. They're not happy with the signing of a truce with the rebels and a so-called amnesty for some of the rebel fighters. They're not happy with this because they actually take to heart all this far-right nationalist propaganda, patriotic propaganda, and they want to put an end to this people. They don't consider them as Ukraine, they consider them as foreign agents, mercenaries, and so on. So it's, in reality, Kiev has unleashed forces which are a bit dangerous even for themselves, you know, they are completely out of their control. Also, on the rebel side, there have been indications of a number of units and even military commanders who are not happy with this deal, who are saying, look, I mean, we're fighting against fascism. Fascism is not being defeated, and our aim is not just to liberate Donbas, but basically to get rid of fascism altogether in the whole of Ukraine. And we're now advancing. Why should we reach a deal? But obviously, it is clear that, and there's also elements of this anti-oligarchic mood which exists in Donbas, and they're not happy. They're saying, well, I mean, the oligarchs are still in government. we should get rid of all of them. And the people should have power. There have been many instances of different commanders of rebel fighters making these sorts of comments. But obviously the Kremlin is not in favor of any anti-oligarchic revolution in Ukraine, or even if it's just in the Donbas, because this will be very, very dangerous also for the forces that are in power right now in Russia. Putin is a representative of the Russian oligarchy. They are not interested in an anti-oligarchic revolution in the Donbas. They are supporting the rebels up to a certain point. They're using them as a bargaining chip to have a say in the future of Ukraine as a whole and to resist NATO aggression, but they're not interested in going the full way. So this is more or less the situation that's been created. As a result of this ceasefire, today the Ukrainian parliament passed a law giving the Donbas special status within Ukraine, but it's not very clear what that exactly means. And there's also a limited amnesty for the rebel fighters, but also the terms of this are not very clear.
Thanks. You've discussed a bit there about the fascist elements involved on the Kiev side in terms of the army and the government as well. Can you explain some of the evidence behind the existence of these fascist elements?
Yes. I mean, this has been clear right from the beginning. And in the Solidarity with the Anti-Fascist Resistance in Ukraine website, we have been publishing material about this right from the very beginning of the campaign. It was clear. The Kiev authorities that came to power after the overthrow of Yanukovych, they didn't hide the fact. They called for volunteers to join the newly created National Guard battalions and the Ministry of the Interior battalions. And these volunteers mainly came from the paramilitary fascist organizations, the Right Sector, Svoboda, Patriots of Ukraine, the Social Nationalist Assembly, and other far-right and Nazi organizations. In fact, one of the first volunteer battalions that was created under the authority of the Ministry of Internal Affairs, i.e. state body, was the Azov Battalion, and the Azov Battalion was created and is made up mainly of members of the Social National Assembly, its paramilitary organization, Patriots of Ukraine. These people are Nazis, they are openly Nazis, and they don't hide the fact themselves. And the commanders of this unit are Nazis and leading members of these fascist organizations. But all of this was not very convenient for the Western media to show, because this is a government that's been supported by the Western powers, by imperialist powers in the US, in Britain, in Europe, and so on. So there were not many reports in the mainstream media about these things. But now in the last few weeks, more and more evidence has come out about this, even in the mainstream media. But one of the latest ones is a video that was shown in German TV news, in the German TV channel ZDF, and it showed members of the Azov battalion, which are playing a key role in the defense of Mariupol, and they had drawn in their helmets Nazi symbols, including a swastika, the SS symbol, and this created a bit of a stir in Germany and in other countries, obviously, because this was a clear indication that soldiers that were fighting under the authority of the Kiev government, in this case the Azov Battalion of the Ministry of Interior, of Internal Affairs, are openly Nazis. And when asked about this, one of them said, "No, I'm not a Nazi, I'm a national. My ideology is National Socialism." It obviously doesn't really make any difference. Others say, no, they're not nationalists, they are patriots. Yes, well, the Nazis were patriots of one particular kind. And other people say, no, their symbol, which is a Nazi symbol, is not really a Nazi symbol. It represents the N and the I, idea of the idea of the nation. But if you then go and look at what their idea of the nation is, the idea of the nation is a white supremacist, racist, Nazi ideology. And they do not hide the fact. I mean, the main commander of the Azov battalion, Andrei Biletsky, he is a Nazi. He's been a Nazi for a long time. He spent time in jail. And you read his writings, even writings he's produced now in August, and he openly says what his idea of the nation is. And not only this, but now the most perhaps shocking thing, but it's not a new phenomenon. It's just a development of what's been happening in the last few months. But Yatsenyuk, who's the prime minister, and Turchinov, who's the president, the speaker of the parliament, have created a new party because there's elections coming up on the 26th of October. This new party is called the Popular Front, and it was launched in Kiev a few days ago. I think it was on the 12th of September. And this party has created a military council, because people in the army are not allowed to be members of a party, so they created this kind of military council to allow people who are involved in the fighting to be part of the party. And this military council is composed of the following people. Arsen Avakov, who's the Minister of Interior. Andrei Paruvi, who's the former Secretary of the National Defense and Security Council, who is a former founder of the Social Nationalist Party of Ukraine, Nazi organization. And then all the commanders of the different volunteer battalions, who are all of them Nazis of one way, of one description or another, including Andrei Biletsky, who's the commander of the main commander of the Azov battalion. So this guy is now heavily rumored that he's going to be in the election lists for the Popular Front, which is the party of the current prime minister and current president of the parliament. So this is a fusion between the Nazi elements and the reactionary bourgeois elements who are now in power. So I mean, the Kiev authorities, you can say, might have certain legitimacy. There was a presidential election after all, but I mean, in reality, this is a very unhealthy mix of right-wing reactionaries, neoliberal bourgeois politicians, extreme nationalists, and some who are openly fascist and neo-Nazi elements. I think that the idea behind this is, since these people have been doing quite a lot of fighting and they have certain prestige out of that, they will use them in their electoral list in order to get better election results. And these are the people who are being supported by the West. So and today, as a reward for all this, the European Union and the Ukrainian Parliament have ratified and signed the European Union-Ukraine Association Treaty. It was the original reason why this whole movement against Yanukovych started. So it is quite a dangerous position. It is not just a situation where Nazi groups or Nazi gangs roaming the streets of Ukraine, but they also been incorporated into a state apparatus, given heavy weaponry, and incorporated into a whole political consensus of bourgeois, right-wing bourgeois politics. At the same time, anyone who's in opposition is being persecuted. On Friday night, three activists, three left-wing activists, were arrested in Odessa. One is a member of Borodba, another member is a member of the Communist Party, and another is a member of the Communist Youth. And one of them, this member of Borodba, he is one of the survivors of the Odessa massacre, where he was beaten up by the right-wing thugs. And three of them have been arrested under the allegation that they are a cell of the so-called Ukrainian Red Army, and they are preparing a terrorist actions. Now, this Ukrainian Red Army has not carried out any actions, and it's quite likely just a fabrication. But in any case, this member of Borodba has been beaten up and tortured in detention, and his relatives are very worried about his safety. They're saying that explosives were planted in his flat when the raid took place by the security agents, and also that fascist elements were also part of this raid on his flat. Not only this, but this person who's been arrested, member of Borodba, is also the editor of the May 2 website, which is a campaign that is trying to bring justice to the victims of the Odessa massacre and to guarantee that there's a full investigation of what happened at that time. It is in this context of attacks on democratic rights. The other day they raided the offices, the editorial offices of this newspaper, Vesti, which has been in opposition to the war, and they raided, they took journalists' personal notes, hard drives, they seized the web server, under the accusation that they had published some articles which could constitute incitation to the breakup of the territorial integrity of Ukraine. So anyone who's really against the government or against the anti-terrorist operation is immediately branded a terrorist, a foreign agent, and action is taken against them. There's also, as we know, legal action being taken to ban the Communist Party, whose the parliamentary faction of the Communist Party has already been disbanded, and so on. So this is the context in which these elections are taking place on the 26th of October.
Thank you. You discussed a bit there about the solidarity with the anti-fascist resistance in Ukraine campaign. Can you explain a bit more about some of the actions and activities that the campaign's doing here in Britain and internationally to support the anti-fascist resistance in Ukraine?
Yeah, the campaign was set up in June, and since then we've organized a number of pickets of the Ukrainian embassy, a number of solidarity activities. And recently, last week, the British TUC, the Trades Union Congress, which organizes over 6 million workers in different unions, passed an emergency resolution moved by the RMT, the Transport Union, which condemns NATO policy in Ukraine. Which incidentally, right now, there are NATO military exercises taking place in Ukraine, which is hardly a contribution to reaching a peaceful deal to the conflict in Ukraine. But this resolution, which is very important, I think is very significant, condemns NATO policy in Ukraine, opposes any involvement of British forces in the conflict, and also offers solidarity of the TUC for those fighting for trade union rights and against fascism in Ukraine. This is very significant, I think. It's obviously the first time that a major trade union body in the West offers its solidarity with those fighting fascism in Ukraine and opposes the policy of imperialism of intervening in Ukraine. I think this is very significant, and we need to use this to maximum effect to build a campaign and to take the campaign down to the ranks of the British trade union movement.
Thank you. And finally, can you just discuss briefly what you think the perspectives are now for the Ukraine?
It's very difficult to say, because even the ceasefire is very fragile. There's still fighting going on. Just a few days ago, Ukrainian army shelling killed about 25 people in Donetsk, even though there is allegedly a ceasefire. But in any case, what I think is that this Ukrainian government is not only carrying out this anti-terrorist operation, but it's also a government that is committed to harsh austerity measures, which have been signed in a deal, in a so-called bailout deal with the IMF. The Ukrainian economy is now in a much worse state than it was when this deal was signed. It's forecasted to collapse by 7% perhaps this year, GDP. And this will mean that whatever government comes in into power after the October 26 elections will be committed to these policies, massive austerity policies, cuts in massive layoffs of civil servants, cuts in pensions and wages, increases in the prices of the utilities, heating, gas, fuel, electricity, and so on. And this can cause a social explosion. At one point or another, this nationalist hysteria, the fog of patriotism, will dissipate. And the real issues of bread and housing and heating will come to the fore. And hopefully the Ukrainian people will wake up to realize who their real enemies are. The oligarchs who were in power under Yanukovych are in power now, and they're using cynically this war, using ordinary working people as cannon fodder as well on both sides of this conflict, to advance the interests and continue the enrichment at the cost of the interest of ordinary working people in Ukraine. And we can only hope that sooner than later there will be a genuine anti-oligarchic movement that will do away with this handful of wealthy oligarchs and manipulating ordinary people in their interests.
Thank you for joining us today, Jorge, and good luck with the campaign.
Thank you.